Okay, good afternoon. Welcome to today's session, which is entitled, Have We Failed at Replication? A Panel Discussion / Debate on Psychology's Replication Crisis. So with us here today, in terms of introductions, my name is Jeffrey Cucina, and I'm here with Ted Hayes. We are both the co-chairs and moderators of the discussion today. And then we have three panelists. We have Edwin Locke from the Department of Management and Organization at the Robert H. Smith School of Business, the University of Maryland College Park. We also have Prasad Patil from the Harvard Chan School of Public Health, Department of Biostatistics, and the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, Department of Biostatistics and Computational Biology, and Simine Vazire from the University of California, Davis. So, today's session, we're going to be talking about the replication crisis that has emerged in psychology. Some of you are probably aware the Open Science Framework recently had a study that was published in Science reporting many attempted replications of psychological studies have failed. So we have three panelists from different areas of psychology and statistics, including IO, personality, social, and statistics. And each of them is going to begin with a brief overview of the replication crisis. So on the panel, we have Ed Locke, who is a James McKean Cattell Fellow Award winner, and he's written a lot about the philosophy of science, especially using the inductive methods, as opposed to deductive methods for studying, for doing research. We also have Prasad Patil, who was the author on a Perspectives on Psychological Science article on replication. He's done other work in reproducibility across multiple areas of science. And then we have Simine Vazire, who has written about the replicability and the quality of published empirical research. And she's also the co-founder and executive chair of the Society for the Improvement of Psychological Science. So each panelist is going to have a five-minute opening statement. And then Ted and I are going to pose eight questions to the panelists, and they'll kind of come up here and sequentially give their answers to them. And then we're going to have time for the audience members to ask questions as well. I'm going to start off just with a brief little refresher on the replication crisis and some of the recent events that have happened in the past 10 years. I've kind of traced this going back to Daryl Bem's work looking at extrasensory perception, or PSI as he called it, in JPSP. He published an article showing evidence of this PSI or ESP existing, and then Ritchie and colleagues tried but failed to replicate his findings. They submitted their paper to JPSP, and the editor just dismissed it, saying JPSP does not publish replications. And they got similar responses from Science and Psychological Science, although they were eventually able to get it published in PLOS ONE. So that led to a series of articles that debated replicability issues in psychology. And then Brian Nozak in the Open Science Collaboration, which is a consortium of researchers from many different universities, attempted to replicate 100 psychological studies and found that only 39 successfully replicated. Although there was a rebuttal by Gilbert and colleagues that suggested maybe the findings were overstated. But nevertheless, this has kind of cast somewhat of a negative light over psychology and psychological research. So just looking in the way the media has been covering it, they've had a lot of negative comments about it. So the Washington Post said that the results were gloomy. The Chronicle of Higher Education said psychology research turns ugly and odd. Slate.com said everything is crumbling. So this kind of idea of like a crisis has kind of almost emerged. And this is something that Ted and I think kind of impacts all areas of APA and psychologists. So practitioners, who Ted and I are both in, we are working on applying psychological findings to real world issues. And if those findings are not valid or not replicable, that presents an issue. Researchers conducting studies, their studies may not be replicable, which is also an issue. And then educators, people that are teaching psychology in schools, if they're teaching findings that haven't been replicated, that presents another issue and also kind of impacts society at large. So we decided to hold this panel discussion on replicability. So with that said, we're going to now go to the five panelists, and they're going to kind of give a little five-minute opening statement about their thoughts about replicability. And we're going to start with Edwin Locke.
The down button. Okay, thank you, Jeff. So what are my qualifications for talking about this subject? 50 years of successful theory building with Gary Latham, which parallels to a great extent the same methodology used by Bandura in developing self-efficacy theory. Now, we all know some form of replication is needed because, after all, experiments can be idiosyncratic. There can be unknown variations. There can be limitations. There can be biases. So this is important. If you feel bad about psychology, why don't you read the article Rigor Mortis about biomedical research? You think we're in bad shape? They're way, way worse. It's a complete chaos. So, but anyway, let's back to psychology. Now, the method that's been pushed, which I think is a big mistake, is multi-lab replications of single studies. Using one task, one methodology, one manipulation, one dependent variable, often sent out to 25 labs across the world, thousands of subjects, tens of thousands of dollars, and more often than not, they don't even come out. For example, the facial expressions causing emotional states, these are four examples I've seen recently, physical cleanliness affects moral judgment, time pressure affects cooperation, and glucose depletion affects performance and ethical judgments. So these are just four big replications. None of them came out. What's the problem? It's the wrong procedure. What you need is replication with deliberate variation. Now consider water. It boils at 212, right? Wrong. You got to qualify that because it doesn't hold if you're at different altitudes. Doesn't hold if you have chemicals, certain minerals in the water. So replication with variation is very critical to science. And this should be deliberate, not accidental. Now, what does real theory building require, which Latham and I have written about over and over? Clear definitions, valid measures. Now, those two things you might say are obvious. They are not. They are not. Definitions are often unclear, and measures are almost random and disconnected from the definition. Generality across forms of the independent variable, generality across types of dependent variables, generality across tasks, generality across subjects, generality across countries, generality across levels, individual, group, and higher levels, replication across time spans, replication across settings, lab versus field versus simulations. Specification, this is very important, specifications of the moderators. So we need replication with deliberate variation, not replication of one narrow study. Supposing these examples I gave you were successful, what would you have achieved? Nothing, except that one method works with one task, one group of subjects in one place. What have you built from that? You can't build anything from that kind of a study. Theory building is a much, much wider process than single study replications based on deductive method. This model, to me, distorts and prevents systematic theory building. Theory building is a process involving many facets and means many experiments. First goal setting theory published in 1990 was based on close to 400 studies, which we integrated by induction. If we had tried to do that through the journals, probably never would have built goal-setting theory. And Bandura's methods were similar. So theory building process goes through a lot of steps, and they're not the steps that people are fanatical about, including the pressure to announce your hypotheses. Science is a method of discovering things you don't know. So I would be happy as a journal editor, and I would never get appointed one, to have people submit papers with no hypotheses. Say, I want to know what happens when I do this, and then if you want to have more believability, you do some replications of your unexpected finding with variation, and then put it all together through cognitive integration, looking for contradictions. And by the way, negative findings, if you see their role in inductive, in theory building, are useful, because unless the person botched the methodology completely, negative findings clue you to moderators. All theories are theories of a specific area of reality. They're not no such thing as a theory of everything. So moderators caused by negative findings and then replicated again are useful. But you're not going to find these if you do 25 replications of a single study. And then when it doesn't come out, since you've wasted all that money and effort, you're stopped. So my view is we have to reject the entire model of scientific research, including the particular model of replication that's being pushed on us. Okay.
Great, thanks, Ed. So up next we have Prasad Patil, who's going to talk about the replication crisis from a statistical perspective.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Prasad. I should probably update my photo. I look a little bit different. So I'm a biostatistician. I'm a postdoctoral fellow at the Department of Biostatistics at Harvard up in Boston and in the Dana-Farber. Replication and reproducibility is kind of, you know, it's not my day job. It's something I'm interested in. Frankly, I don't know if it's anybody's day job. We can probably talk about that later on. I work in sort of developing gene signatures, prediction, statistical methodology, statistical genetics. But you guys in so obviously I'm not a psychologist. I don't know a lot about the studies that you guys do, but I know you're very interested in how they replicate, and I just kind of want to talk about what that means to me. First, I kind of want to take a step back. So the title of this session is Have We Failed at Replication? The title of that OSF paper that came out in Science a couple years ago was Estimating Reproducibility in Psychological Science. Those are two different words. What are their definitions? Do we all kind of agree on what it means to replicate something, what it means to reproduce something? There are other words that you might have seen in headlines that talk about these studies and related ones, like repeatability, validity. And some of these words have specific definitions in different branches of science. And if we're not sort of stating specific definitions for these things at the outset, then how do we know that we're evaluating the same thing? You know, for sort of saying generally, I'm trying to see if studies replicate. Well, I need to know what you mean by that before I can assess whether or not you've made a valid estimation of a rate of replicability. So my first question, I know we have a lot of questions we're going to get to later, but I would ask, do we agree on the definitions of these terms? The second question I would ask is, do all of us find them to be important or not? Again, that kind of depends on how you define these things, but a lot of people might say they're for replicability and they're for reproducibility until a journal asks them to share their data and their code to actually go ahead and ensure that what they did in their publication is actually, you know, what they did with the code and the data, and then people start hemming and hawing a little bit. So how are we going to make progress on these things if there's not full transparency as to what was done, what data were used to assess it, what methods were used to assess it, et cetera, et cetera. So there are a few roadblocks here, I think, before we even start getting to is there a crisis and is there, or have we estimated replicability properly. Irrespective of these definitions, oftentimes statistics are used to make assessments. So in that paper in Science, they compared things like p-values, right? If you guys have read this paper, they had 100 original studies, 100 replication attempts, and they looked at how many p-values were significant. How did confidence intervals overlap, or did the effect from the replication fall into the confidence interval of the original, or vice versa? They looked at average effect sizes. But there were not any clear, so first of all, I'm not sure that a clear definition of replicability was set at the outset of this paper, and therefore there were not clear expectations as to what should we see. I mean, if you look in the statistical literature, there's a paper by Steve Goodman way back, 1992 or something in Statistics and Medicine, where he talks about, if you do one study, so if you take a sample from a population distribution, you calculate a p-value for some effect that you're estimating in that study, and then you do that again, you take another identical sample, do the same thing, calculate another p-value, people sort of overestimate how often those two are going to agree, even if you're doing that identically, right? So oftentimes we're not even really able to do that identically, take a sample from your, this is talking about direct replication. Oftentimes we're not able to do a direct replication, so what do we expect to see in that setting? I guess that's the third question I'll pose here. Are expectations properly being set when we make these comparisons? So kind of getting back to this notion of direct replication, conceptual replication, first we have to sort of separate the two and define them, and second we have to say, how are we going to evaluate them? If we're going to use statistics, what are the assumptions that are made when we look at some of these statistics? What are their distributional assumptions? What comparisons are fair to make? So I guess I would say my first conclusion is you can't use these quantities, the p-values and things like that, to estimate replicability. I'm going to call it replicability. If we don't first establish a definition, and this gets back to this notion of, well, there's sampling variability, right? Even if you're trying to do a complete direct replication, you're going to take a second sample, and you're going to, if you're going to run the same methods that the original study used to evaluate the sample and to come up with an effect estimate, you're still not going to see the same number, right? So how do we compare those first and foremost? Second, if you're introducing other forms of variability into this question, if you're looking at a different population, if you're changing the experimental design, if you're using a different method, are you still attempting to compare what you got in this study to the first one, or is this a new branch of research? And if you want to make that comparison, how are you taking the fact that this variability has been introduced into the system into account when you make that comparison? I don't know that this was done in a lot of the replication efforts that have come through so far. A lot of the discussion between the OSF group and that Gilbert and Gary King rebuttal and the rebuttal to the rebuttal and then the comments about the rebuttal, a lot of that I think is predicated on the fact that no definition was set and that they were operating with sort of different concepts about what it means to replicate a study. And some of the, they didn't agree about what evaluations were used, and maybe some of that would have been cleared up if both sides sort of had stated a specific definition for these things and stated how they intended to evaluate them. So accounting for even some of this variability can change the conclusions that we make about replicability. So the paper that was mentioned earlier that we published in Perspectives on Psychological Science just used a prediction interval approach to looking at, to trying to sort of include, there's variability in the original study, there's variability in the second study. If we take those things into account, what do we expect to see? It's not, a perfect method, but it's one that attempts to at least broach the subject of where variability is coming from and how it affects our conclusions. And finally, if we've not agreed on an estimate of scientific replicability, how do we know what we need to do, and how do we know whether or not what we're implementing is working? If things aren't as extreme as we say, and we're taking extreme measures to fight against it, how do we evaluate these approaches? And if things aren't as bad, and we're putting in sort of simpler approaches to deal with a replicability issue, either way, I think we need to have definitions at the outset, have a more sort of streamlined approach to evaluating replicability, and then we can sort of move forward in terms of addressing it. So, field questions afterward, I guess. Thank you.
Thanks, Prasad. So the next presentation we have is by Simine, Vazire, Replication Practices Can Improve Our Science.
Thanks. So the theme of my comments is going to be basically that we put a lot of effort into critiquing and scrutinizing replication studies, and that's great. And if we could put half that much effort into how we do original research, I think that would be even better. So we hear a lot of criticisms of replication studies that they vary too many things compared to the original, or that they're too similar to the original. We should be doing conceptual applications. It kind of seems sometimes like you're damned if you do and damned if you don't with replication studies. But I think there's a silver lining, which is that a lot of the critiques we've been lobbying at replication efforts, we should also be using those same critiques to evaluate original studies. And that would improve our methods and our science a lot. So I would say that the problem in science and not just psychology is not failed replications. Failed replications is kind of one of the major things that alerted us to the possibility that we weren't doing things as robustly as we would hope. But it's really just a symptom. I think there's now a lot of other evidence besides failed replications of the problem. And again, I don't think it's specific to psychology, but we now know how to evaluate whether a set of original studies is plausible under the alternative hypothesis or under an alternative hypothesis. For example, we know that the distribution of p-values should be right skewed. There should be a lot more p-values very close to zero than p-values just below 0.05. We know the sample sizes are unrealistically small. Our effect size estimates were unrealistic before, and we got to adapt to this new information and increase our sample sizes. So really the problem is more about the methods in the original research rather than the fact that they failed to replicate. I think, you know, we can never test every individual study that's in the literature, so I think we should look at the bigger picture and this broader lesson that there's other evidence besides failed replications about how confident we should be in our body of work. And we now know some of the causes of these concerns about original findings in the literature. There's sampling error for sure, so we're always going to have some type 1 error no matter what. But there's also undisclosed flexibility in data analysis. We allow too much room for authors to cherry pick studies or cherry pick results and not tell us everything else that went into getting that very pretty result. And we allow authors to use the word predict and prediction when they didn't in fact necessarily predict it. So we need to get a little bit more rigid or stringent about using prediction only to mean prediction, about asking authors to disclose more about how they got their beautiful result. And if we fix these problems, original results will be more robust, which will make the need for replication less. So part of the reason there's been so much effort put into replication studies in psychology right now is because of our rising concerns about, well, which original studies can we trust? If we want to know what to teach our students, what to put in our textbooks, what to build our careers on, whether it's worth investing, you know, 5 more years of research building on a particular finding, then replication is probably a good place to start right now because we have a lot of uncertainty about what is solid and what can be built on. Another reason replication studies are getting a lot of attention is they're demonstrating many of these more rigorous research practices, but those aren't reserved for replications. We're seeing more and more people using these more rigorous practices in original studies too. So for example, replication studies typically have larger sample sizes than the original study they're replicating. They typically are pre-registered, they're not always. And there's usually transparent reporting of materials, procedure, analysis code, and data. It's very rare to see a replication study where the data are not publicly available and the procedure and materials are not very thoroughly reported. But this shouldn't be specific to replication studies, right? These are great practices to encourage in original research, and the more we have them in original research, the less necessary it'll be to test the robustness of each finding through replication, because we'll be able to evaluate the robustness of each finding on its own more easily. Replication will always be necessary, but it won't be the only tool we have. So we should apply the same standards to original studies that we currently do to replication. So transparency should be the default as much as possible. There are always exceptions. There are always times when data can't be shared, that kind of thing. But barring those unusual circumstances, transparency should be the default. Confirmatory claims should be reserved for studies that pre-registered their prediction and analysis plan. We should be skeptical. We shouldn't make strong claims. So replication papers, more recently, it's been the norm that replication papers make relatively circumscribed claims, acknowledge that nothing is definitive, we don't know for sure yet, and I think we should do the same for original studies. I have a different view of conceptual applications. I'm sure we'll get into that during the Q&A. I think that both direct and conceptual applications can be useful. direct replications, it's true that if they succeed, you haven't learned anything new, really. You're just more confident in the original result than you were before. So they're not super informative when they succeed, whereas conceptual replications, I would say the opposite is true, that when they succeed, they often extend the theory in a really interesting way, but when they fail, they're very hard to interpret because you don't know if that means the original finding was not solid, may have been a false positive, or the tweaks, the extensions in the conceptual replication didn't hold and the theory doesn't extend to this new context or new operationalization. So I think both are valuable and it depends. If you're already completely certain in the original finding, then absolutely conceptual replication is the way to go. I think those of us who value direct replication, it's probably a function partly of more uncertainty about the original findings, wanting to first establish that we can really build on that original finding before trying to extend it. And then I'll make a controversial point and just as I run out of time, which is that I don't think meta-analysis, even internal meta-analysis within a paper across the studies is gonna save us, and in fact, I think it's gonna dig us into an even deeper hole, and I'm happy to go into that more if people have questions.
Thank you, panelists, and thank you everybody for being here this afternoon, and I'm glad you could be here. I realize you have other things to do. I think this is pretty important, and I believe our panelists are the right people to answer your questions, but I'm going to go a little bit out of turn and ask Simine to announce something that was just announced this weekend at the SIPS conference regarding replication and collaboration with APA.
So at the Society for the Improvement of Psychological Science this week, there was an announcement of a partnership between APA and the Center for Open Science and SciArchive, a preprint server. So actually SIPS is not part of that agreement, but SIPS is So SciArchive came out of SIPS and is in partnership with SIPS, so we're involved. And the agreement is that APA has decided that they are going to allow each editor of their journals to decide whether or not to adopt badges, and I'm not sure if they're going to encourage their editors to adopt them or simply leave it up to the editors. They have decided that they are going to tell their authors that SciArchive is the preferred preprint server for people to post the version of their papers that they're allowed to post on preprint servers, and that OSF, the Open Science Framework, which is run by the Center for Open Science, will provide a place for people to deposit their data. So there will be a data repository that's a collaboration between APA and the Center for Open Science.
Okay, thank you. So that was pretty exciting news. I thought I'd just let everybody hear that. All right, we have several questions to go through. Realize that you may have questions also, so we'll stock the pond here and start asking questions. And there is a microphone back there if you can migrate toward that if you have questions. And if you can't wait, you can migrate now. But let's get going. So the first question we had was, is psychology currently in a crisis over replication, or have concerns been overstated? Unfortunately, we don't have a lavalier, so may just be shouting. Anybody want to take that?
I would say that we definitely have a very big problem. I don't think it's specifically about replication. I think it's just about how, whether we were doing what we thought we were doing, whether we could interpret p-values in the way we thought, whether our findings were as robust as we thought. I don't really have strong feelings about whether the word crisis is warranted or not. I usually avoid using it because it seems to upset people, but I think it's a very serious problem, not at all specific to psychology, not just about replication, but about robustness and validity in general.
Well, I think most of this is on the wrong track. The reasons I said, replication itself is not a way by itself to build a theory. Not going to get anywhere with that. Much, much more complex. It's a whole system of things. And journals are partly to blame. They insist on the deductive method. It's not how science progresses. It progresses by induction first. And it's also unfortunate that once a study is done, they don't want further research on the topic, especially now. Every issue has to be something new and original. And then, for them, theory building process is over. It's finished. It's not going to work. Theories don't get built that way. So, I don't know, I'm not going to repeat things I said. You don't go through the processes of building a theory. Not going to build it. And replication, as such, is not nearly enough at all.
I would say, pertinent to this question, I think the answer is inconclusive, for reasons that I stated in the book. Sorry, I can't hear. Can I go up to the mic?
It's probably, yeah. Okay.
Sorry. I'm the one in this boot, so I'm just going to be near the...
Is there a crisis or have concerns been overstated? I say I don't know. I don't think there's any easy way to evaluate the results of a lot of these studies for the reasons I said, for usage of different definitions of these terms and for an unclear path of like what is being evaluated. I think I find it odd that, you know, this is within the realm of science, and yet I think people had sort of a preconceived notion about how bad this issue was, and then when papers started coming out saying that, yes, it's bad, we took them at face value, and we didn't really stop and consider, well, were appropriate methods used to actually do the things that were said in these papers, actually estimate a rate of replicability, actually involve sort of a scientific process to answer that question. So, although, as was said, a lot of these, the individual replication efforts were sort of nicely done and nicely compared to the original ones, there were differences, and there was no clear way to tell people how to actually evaluate the results of these things in light of those differences. So I don't think the question has been answered.
Thank you. Okay, next question. We'll start with Ed on this one, because this seems to be right up your alley, Ed. Should researchers aim to conduct direct replications or conceptual replications?
I don't use the word conceptual, but if you mean replication with variation, absolutely yes, and it's necessary for scientific progress. How many things in the history of all of science change the direction of anything with one study? Maybe Michelson-Morley study in physics about whether there was an ether. Not sure about this. But you can't get anywhere with that. And ask yourself, with all this desperate passion about single replications and all the things the journals do, how many cases have you seen where a fully validated comprehensive theory was formulated? Now, I don't like the book, but goal setting theory is one of them. And self-efficacy theory is a second one. And I'm not competent to speak on others, but I don't see it much because I think the process is messed up. And I blame the journals a lot for this, but not only the journals. It's the whole mindset of theory comes first, not how science progresses. And if you look at the history of physics, okay, so there's a book on this that I read, the progress came from trial and error and experiments and disagreements and trying stuff and doing stuff in a different way, testing it out and then doing something else, and contradiction, testing that out. It was a very complex interpretive process. It wasn't like the journals. Here's a theory of oxygen. We're going to test it. That's it. Not how it happened.
I agree that a really big problem is that journals want each individual submission to be something novel and groundbreaking, and they don't value incremental progress. And so what we're calling conceptual location, maybe I would totally agree that we need incremental studies that vary things to see whether or not they matter, identify boundary conditions, et cetera. I wouldn't even call that part of replication. I would call that part of, that's just research. It's just doing new research should include incremental advances on past research. And it's true that's not at all incentivized. Many journals won't publish that. You can't get a grant to do incremental research. You have to have your own new theory, et cetera. I think that's a really big problem. I would put that problem in the domain of original research. When we're talking about replication as a scientific self-correction tool, then I think direct replication is more useful, because I think that we need a way to disconfirm things that we thought we knew were true. And direct replication is really, right now, the best tool to do that. I'm open to other tools, but conceptual replication doesn't do that very well because it's ambiguous what a failed replication means. Direct replication is really the best way, in my opinion, to test whether something that has been treated as established fact really is and deserves that that level.
Let me disagree with that. Let's say you do a conceptual replication and you get something different. And to me, that's progress.
If the original
it's
was
progress.
You're assuming that the original finding is robust, though. I agree. If we can be sure the original finding
is robust. Original hypothesis might not come out. So then we change one variable and it comes out entirely different. Okay, you've progressed. So you move science forward, and you say, it's got to be qualification for that.
So you're saying if the original works and the conceptual doesn't, we now know that it works under these conditions and not under those
exactly.
conditions. I'm saying we don't know if it works under these conditions, that first study. So I first want to make sure that's true. Then I want to do original research that's incremental and see, okay, under what other conditions does it or doesn't it? I don't think we really disagree. Because if we knew for sure the original was true, I would absolutely say, yes, let's focus on conceptual applications, boundary conditions. I'm just more skeptical than you about a lot of original findings.
Let me give you an example, okay, from goal setting theory. Okay. Goal setting theory focuses mainly on goals and on goals as mediators of feedback. Not other role of feedback. Mary Maris, 1970s, did an experiment with two conditions. One was goals with no feedback, which goals said nothing about. And the second group, goals with feedback regarding progress. She found it only worked when you had feedback. You've got to track how you're doing. Now, to me, that's a moderate. And it moved goal setting theory forward.
Yeah, I don't disagree with you at all.
Okay.
I think if you can systematically get it and not get it, you know what that moderator is, that's a huge theoretical advance. So let me give you a different example. So take the facial feedback study, for example, the major multilateral application. You said we didn't learn anything because it didn't work. So if someone had done a conceptual replication and systematically varied something and it didn't work there, then that might have been interesting if we could say, well, the original is true and this new null finding is true, so now we have this understand the moderator, but what I would say is, well, what the direct replication taught us is we don't know if the original is true, and we should probably suspend our belief in that original or confidence in that original finding, and that's what the direct replication taught us. And that's a danger of skipping to conceptual replication before we really established the original.
Well, if you want to extend with that, you could say, let's try some different things. See if we can get places where the original one worked. And when you do something slightly different, the original one didn't work. Now imagine when you do an experiment, the number of choices you have to make, so many ways. I know in one experiment, in goal setting, something strange came out. So Lake and I and Eris did a very unique study. We tried to figure out why we disagreed. So we called one of the experimenters who was working for one of them. Said, tell me exactly what you did, including things not in the written up. Turned out that was crucial.
Yeah.
And then we replicated the test. So to me, that's real progress.
Yeah. I agree. I think you need to both be able to reproduce the original and then test it in a new context. I just don't want to skip that first step. But I agree it's not nearly enough. It's a very first step, the very minimum. It's not very theoretically productive. It's more like a safeguard. Because before we get ahead of ourselves, let's make sure we can get it.
Can I ask you guys how, so what constitutes a direct replication to you? And how much, so I'm going to sort of assume here that if you're attempting to directly replicate an existing result, you're going to conduct a study that's as close to the original one as sufficiently possible. I'm going to posit that that's very hard.
So I think we need to do a better job in original studies of stating what between study variables we think should matter and which ones we think you can vary and shouldn't matter. And actually, there's a paper in Prasad Perspectives in Psychological Science, with some of the authors are editors of journals, and they ask that journals adopt a policy that authors should state in the discussion section a statement on constraints on generalizability. So here are the contexts or populations or operationalizations that our findings should generalize to. Here are ones where we don't think it would. If you vary this, we don't predict that you would still get the effect. Here's ones where we don't know, it would be interesting to investigate. Because right now, all the burden is on replicators to justify, well, why would you think it would be okay to do this study in 2017? Why would you think it would be okay to do it in Massachusetts instead of Idaho? why would you think it would be okay to shorten the measure or whatever? And some of that burden should be on the original research, because many discussion sections are written as if this is going to be true for all people everywhere, but then original authors say, oh, no, 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 I didn't meet Massachusetts. So we need to be more balanced in where we place that burden, and more of it needs to go on claims of the original
paper. That's overgeneralization.
Yeah.
Right? And what causes overgeneralization? You don't have the data, right? Do you agree with that?
Yeah. So I think that we need to take the claims in the papers at face value, and if papers claim that they found an effect and they believe it reflects a, you know, cognitive process in humans, then we should be allowed to test it in other humans. And if they say in North America, if they say in college students, you know, then we should test it in the, within the parameters that they lay out, which means original authors are going to have to start being a lot more careful about what they make claims of generalizability about.
Do you think that those can be specific enough?
Yeah, so we have to have a little bit of common sense, so I shouldn't have to put in my study that the experimenter needs to not be drunk, for example. You know, like, there are definitely things that you wouldn't necessarily want to have to list out. But I think we have some sense within, maybe within each subfield, of what are the most common things that vary between studies. So whether they're college students or not, whether the study is in person or online, whether it's a field study or in a more controlled setting, et cetera, we can kind of take those variables that we see vary between studies in our field and say in our discussion sections, these are the necessary conditions for obtaining, that we believe, the conditions that we believe are necessary for obtaining our results, and that we are prepared to say, if you meet these conditions, we expect the effect, and if you don't get it, we're going to take that as relevant to our paper.
You all remember the huge fight over the priming study with aging?
Yeah.
So here it's a study. So they prime older, but not regular people, with aging primes, like tired or sore, exhausted. And then they measured how fast they walked down the hall after, and they left. So this one guy at Yale got this result, published it. And then there was a firestorm, because a lot of people said, I tried 25 times, and I never got it. So here's a great example of what the hell's going on here. And nobody knows, because we did it with Eric and Lincoln and I, when we had this conference. We did it together. There was another study in this medical book I told you about, a medical thing that wouldn't come out. So the two doctors got together and said, we did the same thing, it didn't come out. So they sat side by side, tested, and started doing it. And I said, step 37, I'm using reagent A, took this test tube. I said, well, I'm using reagent B. We all know from the literature that they're above. They weren't. So one step considered trivial was the choice of reagents. But think of the amount of detailed knowledge that you talk about, that you need to deal with something like this and drive the medical research nuts, because their experiments are so helpful.
Well, I'm going to have a prime for happy, excited, thoughtful, forward-thinking. So with all that, here's something, and Prasad, if you would please start with this. What are the statistical considerations in replication?
So I think in light of what Simine was just saying about the burden being on the original researchers to sort of state under what conditions or what things can vary without it affecting the conclusion, I'd like to know more about what you mean by the conclusion there, right? Because from a statistical perspective, I think any change we have to note down as some potential source of variation in the system, right? So whether or not it affects the eventual conclusion or the sort of claim that you're able to make at the end, that may be sort of somewhat different than the statistical comparison you intend to make between the new study and the original one. So I think from a statistical perspective, we need, like I was talking about before, a pretty specific definition of what you did and what the replicator is going to do, because like I was saying before, I think replicating these studies is hard. I think no matter how many sort of parameters you set down and say, you can vary these things and I still expect you to get the same result. Well, I kind of need to know what you mean by the same result. And I need to know if those are, they all affect how you make the comparison between the new effect that you see and the original effect that you see. And I would just say, additional to those things, there are considerations in actually making those comparisons. So it's one thing to, you know, compare the effect estimates, compare p-values and things like that. It's another thing to know what the, you know, underlying distributional assumption for those things is, kind of what you should expect to see when you're making those comparisons in the first place. So you go ahead.
I guess I think there are some tricky statistical issues, but I think sometimes we get bogged down on those, and it can be useful to kind of zoom out. And you talked earlier this morning, I talked about kind of my implicit philosophy of science, because I teach undergrad research methods, and so I try to teach them all what makes science different from non-science or pseudoscience. And one thing is that if you've learned something, if you're doing science and you're accumulating knowledge, then you should be able to predict what's going to happen under some context. It can be very narrow, it can be very broad. You should be able to better predict future. So I think that I'm not sure exactly how that prediction should be formulated, but if an original study is claiming to have contributed new knowledge, then it should be able to articulate what prediction it's making, what would falsify, what would disconfirm their claim. And I don't know exactly whether that prediction should be quantitative, say, well, if you do this study with 80% power, with this effect size, and so on, then I think you should, you know, there's maybe some chance you should get significant result, maybe less than 0.5, or if it should be, more general than that. I don't know. My interpretation of the replication projects, again, I don't think the replication project results are the only reason, only evidence we have that there's a problem, but my interpretation of like Bayesian analysis or Truman's analysis and so on is that, and whatever way you look at it, there's a range of possible interpretations. To me, that whole range is pretty bad. But I know that there are some ways to interpret it in ways that people look okay. I don't think that it comes down to specific statistics. And I don't see a distinction really for replication versus original research. If p less than 0.05 is treated as a good decision rule for the original research, then I think that it's reasonable to ask original authors to make a prediction that they, using a similar type of decision rule, what conditions need to be met for you to take a result as informative, the test of this new prediction that you claim to be able to make now that you have this new knowledge. Although NHST is not a good way to interpret null results, so that really only applies to one potential outcome of the replication study. But there are statistical complications. But I think it's reasonable to expect an original paper that wants to make a claim of contributing new knowledge to tell us what they've learned, what we can now predict that we couldn't predict before.
Would you please go to the microphone?
Sorry.
I'm thinking about what about cross-validation would be the way to go. So, for example, we could treat the original data or the original study as the training data set, and then we use that data set as a training set, and we estimate the parameters that we want to estimate. And then we use that parameter to predict the testing data, the replication data. And then we can see if the test error is small or whatever, and we can make some predictions on the test data and see whatever our prediction can be replicated in the testing data. So, that's what I'm thinking about the statistical consideration in the replication. Yeah.
I mean, to that I would just say, it gets back to the question of how to generalize the original result is, you'd have to kind of be able to say that I expect this prediction I'm gonna make in this new study to, come out like this or come out within this range. And some of that may be affected by how you're collecting the data for the new study. Any changes that may have occurred. I mean, this is the kind of thing that you run into, when you're doing things like machine learning and stuff like that anyway, right? If you're building a predictor, you have to state under what conditions it's going to perform the way that it performed in the original one, right?
Yeah, I agree. The cross-validation, the assumption about cross-validation is that
you need to define everything, every variable, very clearly. Otherwise, you cannot claim that you are doing cross-validation, air pressure, offset time, different, a lot of things. And I think because psychology is very complicated, everything is complicated, a lot of the questions. The previous, they mentioned that some steps you might think that this is trivial, but actually it's not true. It's very crucial. And a lot of those things, those variables often is put into the random part, and it will create some variation, and you didn't account for, and you are not didn't account for that variation, then you won't remember that.
You have to have one cross-validation, which is good, you're not going to build a third. Way, way more wide-ranging than just that.
Yeah, the cross-validation could give you some feel or some confidence about how bad it is your original
plan. As can failures. Indeed, failures can be very useful information. You take it from there and keep going.
Okay, good discussion. Thank you. Here's another twist on that. What level of replication is needed before practitioners can put scientific findings into practice? So beyond publishing stuff, what do we need to know? How confident do we need to be in order to implement some of the findings that we have?
I don't know that replication is necessarily the right way to think about it. I mean, how much confidence or certainty you have in your results is not just a function of how many times it's been replicated. That there's features of the original study that could affect how much or how little confidence you have. So I would be more comfortable putting a finding into practice if the study was pre-registered, was well-powered, et cetera. So if I take two non-replication, just original studies, I might be comfortable putting one into practice and not the other, just based on features of the differences between those two original studies. And then I think in terms of how much evidence you need or how much certainty you need between from original studies and replications, before putting something into practice that's so specific, I think, to the finding. It depends on the risks and benefits. Sometimes there are no risks, and so we might as well put it into practice as soon as the evidence leans in one direction. And sometimes there are huge risks, and so we want a lot stronger evidence.
I don't think doing practice is part of the theory building process, right? Is that introducing new moderators? And context that. So even if you're not finished, what happened? I put this in a real organization. That's part of the theory. But you're right. You can't do something that's going to endanger somebody.
Yeah. To pull back and kind of ask, so this is maybe a dumb question, but what does it mean for you guys to put something into practice? Because I know from the kind of work I do, so suppose you're going to develop some sort of gene signature that you want to make into a medical test that has to do with your FDA approval. And so, you publish a paper and you say use these genes to predict this outcome, and you're not just applying it to patients directly, you're going through this enormous regulatory process, and you spend tons of money documenting everything you're doing, clinical trials, stuff like that. So, are those steps coming into play for you guys when you say take something into practice?
I applied it to myself. Department chair, and I applied it to my faculty who wanted to get tenure. So I said, here's the goal you got to reach if you want to get your pubs and get promoted. So that's a place.
Did it work?
Yeah.
Just check.
But I had to learn to apply it in context. It's really in the larger view of thinking process. So did I have a goal for a number of publications? No. Even though I've had many. I had a goal for keeping 7 projects going at the same time. I have now, I'm retired, I only have about 5. And the reason was you lose time, you focus on one thing, you can't manage it, you have to wait. So I adopted the concept of goal setting to a personal context. Now, my colleague Latham, said, well, what performance goals might hurt? Oops, that's a main effect. And sure enough, it did. As you said, if the task is complex, you've got to have a different kind of goals and learning goals. But as a moderator, that led to a whole new stream of research and expanded the theory. I very much favor expansion of theory. And little by little, you add to see. Now, more lately, we're getting really weird things happening. Students, instead of being given grade goals, are asked to write about their life goals for 2 hours. Might include performance in college, it might not. The process of writing, completely contrary to 30 years of research, the process of writing improves performance. Amazing. But we're inductive, so we love new things. We love new things. Let's expand the theory. We don't worry about it. Well, I didn't replicate. That's okay. We're expanding the theory. So there's a whole different approach in our view of theory building. You know, ordinarily, professor who has 25 or 30 contacted would go bananas. And I've seen him do it. I've seen him do it. He said, this is fascinating.
But how do you know when it's a moderator and when the significant, the first one that worked?
You do a new one where you vary the conditions.
But when, so let's say the first one works, the second one you vary the conditions and it doesn't work. How do you know if it's a moderator or the first one could have been a false positive?
Okay.
Is it possible the first one was a false positive?
Well, again, I believe in the law of causality as an absolute. So all results are caused.
What about sampling?
So sampling error, I don't know how to describe that. So I think when something comes out, it's really a challenge to expand your thinking process. And so rather than building a barricade around your theory and shooting people, which people in my field have done, we say, new discovery, that's really interesting. Let's expand the theory.
I think it's a really good point that in psychology, or at least in some areas of psychology, the ones I'm more familiar with, there isn't the equivalent of FDA approval, so there's this bright line between basic research and putting into practice. And in my area of social and personality psych, I'm trying to think of an answer to your question of what does putting into practice look like in social and personality psych. And there are some cases where there's a clear application, like in schools or even in therapy, things like that. But often, what a researcher does when they decide that a finding is ready to go public and use it to practice is either write a popular book or give a TED talk or something like that. And there is no regulatory body that says, no, you can't write a popular book yet. You need more evidence.
Most people overdo it. As they know.
Yes, not going to name effects.
This kind of work, by the way. Here's how it works. You have an image to project of a secret thing that you think is true. Such as incentives don't work. A little bit more. So you gather all the negative studies you can, put them in the book, and you ignore all the other things. This happens over and over again. So don't be too swayed by those kind of books. They're popularizers, not scientists.
Okay, good. We're doing pretty well on time, and again, if people have questions, there was that one question that was pretty good. Please feel free to jump in. Let's go to the next one that we stocked the pond with here. So talking a little bit about selective publishing and finding only certain types of studies and putting them out there, what about meta-analysis? Is meta-analysis with publication bias tests a solution to the replicability crisis? And I believe that Professor Vazire already was in the negative about that, but do you wish to expound upon that?
I haven't yet seen a publication bias correction that can produce an accurate effect size estimate. I think we can detect publication bias pretty well. I've seen many tools. I think they all have something to contribute. I'm not partisan about which tool, but I think together they can give us a pretty good indication of when we should be worried that the replication bias can lead to those set of studies. How to get an accurate effect size estimate once we know that there is replication bias in those set of studies? I'm not convinced. I'm not a statistician, but my statistician friends disagree with each other, and I haven't seen any compelling case that can be made that we can correct the estimate for the replication bias that we know is there. And then I think that the danger of meta-analysis is that it gives you false confidence, that you think, oh, okay, well, a bunch of marginally significant or barely significant results, each one on their own is weak evidence, but you combine them all together, you get a really robust result with a really tight confidence interval, really small p-value. And one thing you forget is that, okay, but if you take that set of studies with p-values of 0.02, 0.08, 0.04, 0.06, that set of p-values does not come from a distribution of a real effect. If there's a real effect, you usually get a bunch of p-values close to zero, below 0.01, below 0.05, to say something controversial. So we still have to explain why is it okay to meta-analyze these studies and take the meta-analytic effect if that distribution of results is not what you would get when there's a real effect. I think it's dangerous to use that meta-analytic estimate at all because it can give people a false sense of confidence. If the studies going into the analysis are pre-registered and the t-test that's being put into the analysis is a pre-registered test, then I think we're safe. And then we should see that distribution. When there's a real effect, we should see a rate speed distribution of p-values with many, many of them close to zero. So that's my main concern, that you know, you could take a bunch of studies that are capitalizing on chance, exaggerating effect, engaging, you know, that are exaggerated by degrees of freedom or flexibility in the analysis. And even with no real effect there, you could get a set of many studies with that together look convincing when in fact there's no real effect. I think there's a couple of literatures now where Devin suggests that might be what happened. There were dozens or sometimes hundreds of published articles on an effect, but the pre-registered studies don't show the effect. And it's hard to believe that there could be that many studies that produced a false positive, but I think we have to entertain that possibility. And then that means that the analysis becomes not very useful. If it's possible to produce many, many individually weak studies that together look strong when there's no actual effect.
I would tend to agree, and I would also say, you know, if these things aren't locked down like we've been talking about, if there is interstudy variability and you're trying to combine all these things together, you're running with the same problem we've been talking about, comparing replications to each other. If more of these things are stated at the outset that following variations across studies are acceptable and these are not, that may change how we combine these estimates in the first place, right? You may be seeing wider ranges for a particular effect than the ones that are being reported because there are a lot of assumptions, a lot of this variability certainly average of these combinations. So maybe something to do.
A little bit tricky. I'm not a statistician, but supposing some of the bad studies between the meta-analysis were done better. But you didn't have a theory to say, here are certain key principles that I can get from reading the article. The question is, what do you make of it? Because to me, very, very comfortable. I'm not going to say that I don't think it's a statistician.
We'll try to speak up. It's hard, but we'll make it work. Okay, thank you. So here's another question that we came up with. Jeff and I and some of our colleagues a couple of years ago put out an article regarding what the scientific method is. And presumably, if one were to follow that, you'd have better results, and part of that might be pre-registration and so on. So if we were to follow those types of scientific method principles, do we think that we would reduce the risk of non-replicable findings?
I'd say yes, and you should follow that, and you should document that you followed it so other people can verify that you followed it. I don't think it's not scientific to say, trust me, I followed this method. You should be able to show where you wrote down your prediction, so basically pre-register and show all your work along the way.
I think we start. Science, just questions. I'm probably in favor. I have a question. Now, whole career, one editor published one article where I introduced my question. Never will happen again.
Yeah, I agree that journals should be open to publishing things that are presented as very, you know, the beginning stage, the hypothesis generation stage, and not require that those studies be dressed up in confirmatory language and pretend to be at that stage. But when we get to that stage, we should follow them.
I mean, I agree. I think this is a great approach. I just want to be sure that people are doing it that way. And I don't know, how difficult is it to ensure that somebody actually follows these steps? I would say it's not critical.
Okay, thank you. Appreciate that. Do multi-study articles, such as the types published in JPSP, address this the replicability issue?
For the same reason that I'm skeptical of that analysis, I'm very skeptical that multi-study approaches are the way to go. Unless, if each study is pre-registered and reported transparently and so on, then sure, more evidence is better than less evidence. When there's not transparency and not pre-registration, then more evidence is not or what looks like evidence.
Well, a lot of the criticism, you know, follow up stuff is like, if the study is small n, is that correct?
Part of the
problem.
Small n's are part of the problem.
Yeah. All right. All right, we're converging. And this is the final question that we wanted to put out there for our panel, and then have more input from you all. In the future, will we need to re-replicate findings that have been replicated? What do you think?
You know, my view is quite a different approach. I won't answer. Except to say, don't approach it that way. Just grow your knowledge.
I think it's absolutely certain that in 50 or 100 years, we'll realize there was some fundamental assumption we're making now that's completely wrong. Which is all the more reason to document everything, have everything transparent, so that later we can go back and reanalyze it the new right way, or look at the materials and procedure and see whether we made that horrible mistake that lots of people were making back in 2017 and weren't aware of. So yeah, probably.
I would say, along with the theme of what I've been talking about this whole time, it depends on what you mean by replicated and what you mean by evaluation of replication. If you're doing with statistics, especially things that are frequentists that rely on long run, like p-value or confidence interval, then, I mean, those are making statements about repeated efforts of the same experiment. I don't know if we even agreed on how much replication is necessary. If we're going to say we need to do direct replication, I tend to favor seeing a distribution of effects over, you know, is one replication of an original study enough or not? I don't know if that has been answered. I would lean towards no, and I would lean towards doing it as often as possible to sort of try to understand what the distribution of those effects looks like.
History of science, the history of constant discovery, because we're not omniscient. So what we could say is we can build knowledge incrementally, which obviously we have seen the benefits for survival and well-being, but can never be certain outside the context of what you know. Certain things are contextual based on what's known now. But I can't say nothing will ever be discovered that's different. Because we don't know. We have to be open to constant new discoveries, which is what science really is.
Great. Thank you. Really good discussion. All right, well, this is the part where you get to talk because you have a microphone and our panelists do not. So, oh, okay, great. Thank you.
And I'm even going to actually ask a question.
Oh.
But I want to reframe the question that I feel like has come up throughout this session a little bit. And I want to ask the panelists if they believe that in psychology, we should believe any and every study that's published to be unquestioned truth in terms of the existence, direction, and magnitude of its findings. Because I feel like if the answer to that question is anything other than an unenthusiastic yes, which I think it should, given the self-admission rate that psychologists have for how often we do questionable research practices, if your answer to that is anything other than yes, I don't see how replication doesn't have to play some role in psychology. So.
I think where we might disagree is whether there are false positives in the literature or how often they exist. So I think one of the things that came out of the discussion for me is that we might not agree on if something works one time, can we trust that that was real, that was real effect and it wasn't a false positive, or do we need to continue to test that specific narrow finding again to be sure?
Yes, positive. You know, you can't approach science from the point of view, you've got to do something in your ambition from then on about that subject. It doesn't work.
But I don't know that I've heard anyone argue that.
The implication of the way you formulate it is you discover something, in the context of your knowledge, you say, this is true. But you can't say, in the context of all knowledge ever to be discovered in human history, who knows? Or it's not true. You don't know. So you have to hold in mind context.
But if you think you know that it's true in that context.
Well, basically, if this, again, you have to say, what are the standards for evidence? I mean, this is really a field of epistemology in philosophy. Science needs an epistemology. So you have to know the criteria and means of knowledge. Why do you think it's
getting at, but I think sometimes, at least in my sub-area of psychology, we often treat published results as if we now know it, and we can move forward as if that's true. And I think, yeah, I think it's an epistemological question, but we've been very, very loose with our epistemology.
Pretty
low standards to say that we know something.
When I read the article, then all of us
Well, let me ask this, then, why are we skeptical? Is it because the study is not done well? And if it's not going well, why is it
published? Very good question.
Well, you're not an embarrassing question.
No,
it's that way it shouldn't be.
Yeah, I think that, so Paul Spolino and Richard McCullough have a great paper about this, about they take an agent-based modeling approach to look at what incentive structures can produce a literature with a lot of false positives. So they make assumptions, you know, to start, but they show that with certain incentives, so if journals want to have a high impact factor, they want to prioritize novelty, and things like that, and researchers are incentivized by publishing in top journals, which obviously that's uncontroversial, that leads to a perfect storm that can produce, can the journals to uncritically accept the papers not based on rigorous methodology, based on flashiness of findings, status of the researcher, likelihood that they'll get cited or picked up by the media, things like that. And also I think that sounds so much more evil than I mean it. I think also we don't know what to look for. So we thought, you know, there were literally advice from senior people in our field telling us that 15 people per cell is enough for a between subject study with an implicit, you know, prime or something like that. And now I think I would better understand it's not realistic assumption about effect sizes, that there were norms based on the best available information at the time that led us to think that that studies were solid that weren't.
Here's something relevant to your question and your comment. This is becoming very common and very disturbing to me, not as statistical. But here's a study you see over and over again. Correlation for the main effect was zero. Okay? Zero. They have 12 control variables. Suddenly, through a process of mathematical magic, it's highly significant at the 0.01 level. And then the conclusion is, hypothesis is verified. Now, I'm not a statistician. Seems to me to be witchcraft. I'm very, very unhappy with that. Didn't used to happen. You couldn't get away with that. But now I see it every issue. I don't know. You're more expert than I am. What do you think of that?
Yeah, it's a really good problem. I think it's very common. And I think part of the push for transparency and open science is so that we can know, oh, you had to try those 12 different covariates and so on. And then we can calibrate our problems and say, okay, well, you found something interesting, but very well you have like
whoever replicated that study with the same 12 control variables, nobody. So this, pyramid of study like that, how could you accept that?
What's even more scary to me is other studies where you don't see the other 11 control variables. So it looks like they did one test and they found something, and then they're selling it as something that was planned and that's how they always meant to analyze it and so on. So for all the ones where you see the 12 covariates, there's ones where you don't see them, but they were there and they were tried and then not reported.
Yeah, very upsetting to me to see them.
Well, I would say, to what you're kind of talking about, which maybe is related to this notion of p-hacking, where it's sort of looking at all possible associations and just reporting one that's significant and trying to sort of make a story around that. If I do that with a huge sample size and I do nice power calculations and I say, look, I have great power to detect this effect and detected one, I'm just not telling you that I looked for hundreds and I found this one and I accounted for all the variables. Say I should account for and I had thousands of subjects or something. I would maybe look at that paper and say, okay, this looks good, and I'm probably not able to replicate this, right? Because it's going to take a lot of effort to gather such a large sample, and
all of those results are based mathematically on covariation, right? If it's a covariation, when you get zero, then it comes out. So if you have a theory of covariation for those 11 control variables,
Yeah, I think there's the dangers that we're getting, right? So this cross-validation could be really useful. But I think, in general, it's some philosopher of science, who I shouldn't remember anything, said, you can't use the same sample to generate a theory as you can to test it. So I think that paper should be framed as a hypothesis generation paper that I played around with these. And I had this, it's like 6,000 variables and so on, and we found this one association that looks really interesting, but we won't know if it's real until we get another sample. I agree that collecting another 1,000 people is hard. Maybe there's already an existing data set that has similar enough variables, or if you know ahead of time that you want to play with your data, and I play with my data all the time, I think it's very, not only is it okay to do, I think you have responsibility to do it, given the amount of money and time that goes into collecting data sets like that. So if possible, and I hope to do this in the future, I didn't think of it my last data set, that is to split the sample to do field across validation. But if I can't do that, then I'm going to treat any results I find from exploration as very, very sensitive, like something to investigate in the future, not something to start putting into practice.
I agree, but if it's not reported as such, I'm not going to know that you did that, and I might be ready to go ahead and start conceptually replicating this idea. Right?
I think that's the situation we've been in.
Good questions. Thank you very much. Good discussion. I think that's actually the point that the woman who asked the question earlier was getting at, is trying to make predictions based on a seed sample where you just found something and try to extrapolate inappropriately. Any other questions or comments that you have? Everybody too shy? Are there any closing thoughts that you, our panelists, have regarding what we should do from here?
Yes. Don't believe what you read about how to build theories. They're wrong. All the stuff I've seen, they're wrong.
Well, that's that further. I say, don't believe what you read. I think that there's more skepticism than that. We should. We have to take a step back and think about, do we really know the things we think we know, and the things we put in our textbook, build on and so on. And I think we should back up a step and test those things again before building.
Yeah, I would just say, pertaining to the initial question of your crisis and replicability, I mean, do you feel that we've answered that question today? But I'm not so sure. I would say if you already believe that there is a crisis, then when you read the stuff that's out there, it's just going to continue to support that notion. I, again, don't feel like a strong statement has really been made that way, and I think that probably should affect what researchers intend to do next in terms of how they intend to deal with it. But, I'm coming out more confused than I came in.
Well, that can happen when you come to Washington. Yes, sir.
I have a question. It all seems so bleak. don't believe anything you. I'm having this thought about when we discuss this crisis, not crisis thing, and I wondered if you sort of had some sort of bird's eye perspective on psychology as a science. You know, what kind of demands are we supposed to put on this subject matter that we're studying? We're trying to understand why people act and think and feel the way they do. It's a very, very complex subject matter. And we've been doing it since, what, 1850-ish? And, you know, proving Fermat's grand theory took, what, 400 plus years? So I'm sort of wondering, are we putting too high demands on this science that we're conducting, trying to discover objective laws, and the journals that you've been talking about, they only want these kinds of shiny results. And I'm just wondering if you could give some like overarching thoughts about is this really the what we're supposed to, are these demands what we're supposed to be putting on the science that we're doing? A bit messy question, but yeah. Oh,
interesting question.
Yeah. Well, I think you have to start with the issue of method and content as a starting point. Psychology was terrorized for 50 years by a completely irrational theory, behaviorism, which claimed that we didn't have a mind, or if we did, it was completely irrelevant to everything we did. And why? And the reason was Skinner and Watson were desperate to be respectable by imitating physicists. Psychology is not physics. So that died out and it collapsed. So we replaced a lot of that with statistics. But the most important method in psychology, in my view, you take one method, start with is introspection, which is a dirty word. I went to a word search for introspection and sex in psychology. There are about 20 or 30 references to introspection and about several thousand to sex. So you know which is the forbidden fruit. Right? So if you say in an article, I figured this out from introspection, kiss your article goodbye. I'm not saying it's the only method, it's not, but it's been disrespected. Holdover from the influence of physics. So I think the whole issue has to do with method. That's the one aspect of method. And the other method is what's the proper way to build theory? It's a very difficult question. And needs a lot of work. I've written on this. I think I've written on this. It's something that needs a lot of thought. I think the way we're told to develop theory is completely wrong. It hasn't led to theory. I think what Latham and I have been doing, and what Vazire has been doing, has been extremely fruitful if we use a certain method. So to me, the whole methodology is the key issue that all the human priorities come about. So yeah, we're kind of in a problem. Because we're getting off on the wrong start.
Balance right now of putting things out there before we really have good evidence,
or whether we should shift that more towards becoming a little bit more conservative than we are now. But I think we do need to pay attention to the problem, the potential problem of being too conservative, of requiring too much evidence before we let anything be published or put out there to be tested in the inclusion. Yeah, there is such a thing as being too, going too far in the other direction. I had one more thought about your question about what does it mean to replicate something, or how do we know when we've replicated something? And I was thinking about it, and I think really, I hope we can answer that question, because it's really just a more specific version of the question of how do we test a prediction. If we don't know how to formulate an answer to how do we test a prediction, we can't do original research and plan replications. And in my mind, all that a replication is saying, okay, well, what is the claim being made in this paper? What do they say they found? Let's treat that as a prediction. Test that prediction. And so that claim needs to be contextualized. If the original authors of the theory makes a very specific claim, then we should test that specific claim. If it makes a broad claim, then that gives more freedom in terms of testing that prediction. But I don't think there's anything special about testing a claim that's based on an original finding versus testing a claim that's based on introspection or on theory or other things. I'm not sure the challenge of how do we define replication, how do we define successful replication, any bigger or smaller than the challenge of how do we test a prediction.
I think I buy that, and I think maybe one of the differences that we haven't really touched on is who is supposed to be doing these replications. So the difference between testing and original, maybe like a new idea, is that there's some incentive to try to get that thing published. That might help your career. Is there any incentive to try to replicate existing, maybe if you're talking about conceptual replication, then I feel like you said, you have to have a pretty strong belief in the original one to want to go ahead and try to extend it. If you don't believe the original one, what are you supposed to do with the efforts you put into trying to confirm talking about the direct replication of the original one? And like you guys mentioned earlier on, the paper that tried to replicate failed, there was no hope for it. Who's supposed to do this? Why are they supposed to do it?
Yeah, right now, there's no incentive. But part of, I think, the effort to address this crisis, or whatever you want to call it, is to try to change the incentive structure so that there is appropriate recognition for that work.
Do you think that's possible, though?
I think you can get around that problem in the following way. Instead of doing a direct replication, let's say it's boring, you would use the other moderator.
That might allow you to publish the failure in addition to...
Yeah, because you have failure, but you've got a new discovery. It's a limiting condition. That's useful knowledge.
But then you can never refute, if the original is not true, you can never go...
If you have two conditions, the way it was done in the original, and then you have a variation. When you do the variation, it doesn't work.
What if the original is not working?
Yeah.
That's
the question. We've all said this about this.
I mean, there's a question about other... But to answer your question of whether I think it's realistic to change the incentive structure, I just came from a meeting with 200 people. I was organized pretty much grassroots on the fly, where they spent 3 days just trying structure in psychology and change practices to improve themselves and provide resources for others who want to improve. They're not journal editors and grant agencies, so it's going to be an uphill battle, but I do think it's worth trying. I don't know. Some days I'm optimistic, and some days I'm not.
Why don't you try to found a new journal?
Yeah, it was one of the 7 hackathons on forming a new journal, and in fact, and we also just partnered with an open access journal, Collaborative Psychology, out of the University of California.
Reasons to be cheerful. Okay, good. Thank you very much, panelists. I really appreciate it. Any final questions or thoughts from the audience? Richard, you have any thoughts? No? Okay, good. Thank you very much. Really appreciate it. We'll be talking again sometime soon. Thank you. Very good.